What the guns that were destroyed have become now. Palm Sunday, volunteers are needed. It is a hands-on, all hands-on-deck event. And so there is a sign-up sheet, if someone would pass it around, where you can sign up to help out or even set up or even just transport stuff. Any little bit helps. Holy Week is upon us almost, and so we have some special events planned for that. Of course, we have our big Palm Sunday parade and celebration next Sunday, which will be happening with Neighborhood Church. There is a Maundy Thursday dinner and service. Please scan the QR code located on your bulletin to RSVP for that so we can make sure our friend Bud, who is cooking for us, will make enough for everybody. And there's also a Good Friday service at Bunton Presbyterian on March 29th at 6:30. Beer and Hymns will be happening on Friday, April 5th at Hempline Brewing at 6:30. If you want a free burrito box, scan the QR code in your bulletin. And you can reserve your free burrito box. You don't want to miss out on that and the $5 beer specials. Bibles Over Breakfast is back April 11th to May 20th, Thursdays at 8 a.m. over Zoom. And this time, they will be covering Romans. So you don't want to miss out on this informational, fun Bible study sesh. The reception for the items made by the Metal Museum artists for Gun Cigars.
Here at the church on April 20th from 6 to 7:30. The work will stay in this space on display for 2 weeks afterwards. So make sure you either come to the reception or make sure you come anytime within those 2 weeks to see what was created from the tools of destruction that we destroyed. Free t-shirts are on the front counter, so just take them. Catherine called them free shirts. Now I must ask you to rise in body or spirit as we bring in the light.
God of these 40 days, we do not expect you to battle this season with us. From the ashes that mark the journey's beginning,
to the cross that marks its end, your steadfast love guides us.
Lead us through the wilderness.
For the new life that awaits us in your world. Now please remain standing in body or spirit for opening the number 247. 247. Now the green blade rises.
join me in our flourish language. Flourish.
Alone, together. We practice wholehearted life, alone and together. Evergreen is an open and affirming faith community, rooted in the way of Jesus. We grow through spiritual practices that nourish the individual and cultivate a more compassionate world.
Friends, hear this truth. We are God's beloved, and we are created to live peacefully, in community, in friendship, with one another. There is nothing we can do and nowhere we can go to be separated from the love of God. Since God has forgiven us in Christ, let us forgive one another. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Please pass the peace of Christ to one another.
Peace, Cam. Peace, everybody.
Rosalind. Hey. It is time for wandering time, guys. Y'all had a minute and 30 seconds to pass the peace. It's the kids' time now, okay? All right. You see how I do that? See how I got y'all's back? Okay. All right. But that wasn't really, what is this word? Disciple. Can y'all say, everybody say this word? Disciple. Can y'all tell me what that word may mean? To teach, student. What do you guys think that it means? Open this up. You have that right there. What do you think to be a disciple means? You don't know. That's a good answer. A learner. That's a really good answer. A disciple is someone that learns and goes out and spreads the word of God, the word of Jesus, right? They tell people about how good God's been to them. And God actually chose 12 people. You okay, Miss Sylvia over there? Okay, we'll do that. Now, he actually chose 12 people to be those disciples, to follow him and to go out and do all of the good things. And actually, one of those people were children. Can you just imagine a child being a follower of Jesus and being the model like you, Miss Betty? He wanted everybody in here to be just like you. Can you imagine that? Why do you think God wants everybody in here to be just like you? Why?
Be nice.
Exactly, because he wants everybody to be nice, right? Because kids, we have me, because I'm still a kid, we have clean hearts, right? But everybody gets to see and love everybody in different ways, right? You see how you guys are loving on one another right now? Some of us adults can't even do that, right? We go to work and we argue and do all that different stuff. Now, exactly, and that's not disciple-like, right? Jesus does not want us to do that, okay? So I have a few questions for you guys, okay? Pay attention, because I want to see if you guys can get this.
Let's see. Now, okay, you guys work together to get this, okay? If you guys were walking home from school and you seen someone, okay? You seen someone that looked like they needed a friend, what would you do as a disciple? Would you keep walking and ignore them? And it's somebody that you went to school with, right? They're walking from school and they look a little sad. Would you keep walking away from them, or would you maybe go and console them? I think that may be the burnt stuff. You see, it was something with the air. We were trying to figure that out earlier. Yeah. But would you be nice, or what would you do?
None of the above. I don't walk.
Okay. Well, that's good. Your parents don't allow you off.
If you did.
Yeah, what would you do if you did?
Try to cheer them up.
Try to cheer them up. Good job. Give that.
I would do the same and try to do a funny dance.
And try to do a funny dance to make them laugh?
And a few jokes.
Yeah. You like it too?
Wait, can I tell
this? And then you tell your joke, okay? Wait. All right. What if you're on the playground and you see someone bullying another child on the playground? You and your friend, or your friend wants to go somewhere else and they're going to ignore them. What do you do as a disciple and a follower of Jesus? If you see someone getting bullied on the playground, what do you do?
Tell an adult.
That's a good job. Yeah. Clap it up for them. That's good. What would you do, Miss Betty, if you seen one of your friends getting bullied on the playground? What would you do? Y'all pay attention. What would you do?
Stop it.
Pay attention. That's not disciple-like. What would you do at the playground, though?
Well, I don't want it on my journey.
Hey, let's be disciples. Be nice. Be nice. What would you do as a disciple, Miss Betty?
I would tell them to stop.
It's like bullying. And Miss Celia, last but not least, because I thought you wanted to tell a joke.
Yeah.
All right. What would you do as a disciple if you seen someone on the playground being bullied?
Why your arm?
No. Answer the question. Don't tell a joke yet. What would you do if you seen someone bullying someone on the playground?
Tell the teacher,
yeah. Now, don't stand up to the bully, because that could lead to other situations that we don't want to be in, right? We can just tell the teacher and let the teacher handle it, okay? All right, y'all snap it up for them. Snap it up. You want to say your joke? Okay.
This is a clam joke. Okay. Why did the clam scream in pain? Because he pulled a muscle. Get it?
Y'all snap it up for me.
Because muscles are latex.
Don't y'all love these kids? Happy Wondering Time, St. Patrick's Day. All right, y'all, let's go to the table.
I haven't had the pleasure of meeting you yet. I'm Patrick. I'm the pastor here at Evergreen Presbyterian Church. Our gospel reading for this morning comes from John's gospel. But before we get to that, I'd like us to share a word of prayer. So I invite you to pray with me. Holy God, as we encounter these words from your gospel, may the Holy Spirit speak to us anew. May these words be very much alive in our minds and in our hearts. May we hear with joy and deep curiosity what your Spirit is saying to us today. Amen. The reading, 12th chapter of John's Gospel, verses 20 through 33. Let's hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Now among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and they said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew, then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Humanity to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life will lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Now my soul is troubled, and what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. God, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." The crowd standing there heard it and said it was thunder. Others said, "An angel has spoken to him." Jesus answered, "This voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. The grass withers and the flowers fall, but the word of our God endures forever. Amen. In John, Jesus talks a lot. If you ever had one of those red letter Bibles where Jesus' words are in red, John's gospel is a lot of red. John also loves to use lots of metaphors, and this is one of the common ones. The gardening, things growing, agriculture, seeds, plants, all that. Very common throughout a lot of scripture, but especially in John, because again, John loves metaphors. So before we get into too far into the sermon, I've got something which I thought was going to be really fun and no one would have, but then this church goes and is too cool, so this is these. I mean, you've already been handed these out, but this is going to be the prize for a quick tricky question. Yeah. So I guess you're not for thinking that y'all aren't on your St. Patty's game. True or false question. The first person I hear, don't raise your hand. First person I hear to shout the correct answer. I'm going to toss these out. So look alive. True or false? Patrick is really, 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 really good at gardening. This is not because my parents didn't try. If you were to drive to my parents' address on Appian Way in Greenville, Tennessee, you would see the house that I think it got finished. They built it when I was in fifth grade. I think it was like April Fool's Day we moved in. Great day to move in. 1999, I believe. And the garden and the lawn, everything just looks immaculate and it's beautiful. My mom so many times has said that during lockdown it was getting to go out and work in the garden and get her hands dirty that really kept her feeling good and feeling alive and connected. They have a beautiful lawn, and they've even gotten like local awards, lawn of the year, all that kind of stuff, and they get to put the sign out front. And now there's a little library, one of those free little libraries. My dad built it, my mom painted it, and I think it's the Very Hungry Caterpillar, I think, is, you know, along the back of it. Beautiful, beautiful yard and lawn. And they tried to teach me, and I wouldn't listen. And when I was in high school, I worked a little at my dad's work, doing some lawn stuff here and there in the summers. And there was one day in particular, I remember, I had to weed eat an entire bank of what I realized about lunchtime was poison ivy. The paycheck for that day covered about a third the cost of the poison ivy medication. And when I brought this to my supervisor, Randy Harley, I think there was some lesson about character development and that it was left at that. When I got to college, my freshman year, I decided, okay, my roommate and I decided we're going to try growing something. We're going to try to keep a plant alive. We each bought a $1.99 Venus flytrap at Walmart. We'd only seen movies and cartoons, and we were thrilled at this idea of a violent, predatory plant in our dorm room to protect us. I remember we set up some of that fly tape that looks real gross, you know? It really brings the whole dorm room experience together when you have one of those hanging up. And we would take flies off of that and then try to feed it to the Venus flytrap to help it grow strong, and it would move real slow, not really do much. I thought, okay, we're doing it wrong. And then my roommate, Kevin, he said, what we have to do is get a live fly because it wants to hunt, right? And this is the thrill. It misses the thrill of having to close quickly on something that could get away. So then we spent our important time in the library trying to catch live flies. About a week into this project, we did in fact catch a live fly. We brought it home, and the Venus flytrap's still too slow. I think mine lasted another week, and I just tossed it, I'm ashamed to say. Kevin kept his alive for about a year and a half. I don't remember how, but he did. And then a little later in my college time, I'm on staff at First Presbyterian Church of Auburn, and I graduated in December, and I was going to do this, you know, young adult volunteer year program. It doesn't start till August. I still have my lease, so I get more hours at the church, and I'm doing odd jobs, you know, so just kind of hang around Auburn for about 6-7 months. And one of the odd jobs I did was for a woman named Mary. Her nickname was Mother Mary. And Mother Mary would have me out there to pull weeds one day. And this is a woman who, when you saw her on Sunday, she was always in pastels, even when it's winter and everything. And she loved a bonnet to church, a wonderful Southern lady. Any other day of the week, she is in overalls, and she's dirty, and she is a hard worker. She is a farm kind of person. And so I went out, what I thought, but I really didn't know her that well. I went to go pull weeds because obviously, like, she can't do it all on her own, which is my own, just, you know, ageism and sexism coming to light, because she's working circles around me out there. And I'm out there for a couple days, and then that Sunday, I was actually getting to preach for the first time at First Presbyterian Church of Auburn, and so I preach, and I've been told, I've been educated by the pastors there that, you know, everyone being Southern, everyone feels like it's important to shake the hand of the preacher as you leave the front door, and sometimes folks want to talk a little while, which is wonderful, but you need to shake everyone's hand with your right hand, and then with your left, kind of move them along, man. And then if they want to keep talking, you can say, "Oh, I'll talk to you right out." You know, but you got to get everyone out because you got to beat the Methodist to lunch, kind of thing. So you got to shake, and you got to just, and then you can go catch up and have more conversation once everyone's through the line and everyone's out the door. So Mary comes over, and I'm thinking, oh, I don't care how long she wants to talk, I wouldn't dare. Like, this woman was so much fun to work with. I love working in her yard. So I'm shaking her hand. And then she comes close and gives me one of these hugs. We're hugging. And her bonnet's resting now on my head. And she says to me, "You're so much better of a preacher than you are a weed puller." Okay. Let's go along for the next person. It's been years since that moment, and I'm still terrible at gardening and keeping things alive. I actually thought this morning I had this idea where I was going to bring in little pots for everyone to dig in, but I knew that would end up in me having to clean it up. So I thought twice about that. So my thumb is far from green, but even still, I hope that I and any of you who share the struggle as plant parents can find meaning in what John is saying in this metaphor, as John tries to reveal the truth to us in this moment with Jesus teaching disciples and also some new friends, these Greek folks that come and want to meet Jesus. But it's important to remember that John has a very unique context, and he's writing with some things in mind. He does have an agenda, and we hope that the Spirit speaks through to that. There's one big thing going on in John's time and in John's location during this day, and that's something called Gnosticism. It starts with a G, GN, Gnosticism, and this is the idea that flesh and body is bad, right? Like, everyone was just like, no, anything that's like the natural earth, the dirt, your bodies, everything is just bad. And Jesus only looked to be human. It was all just kind of, you know, like, it was just kind of mirrors and magic tricks, right? Like, he actually was just fully divine, because nothing, the divine would not be in our dirty, nasty, sweaty world, right? But it was important to John, and that's why you see so many of those old creeds that talk about, you know, fully human, fully divine, because this was a big debate of the day. It was important to John to say, no, the divine is in this sweaty, dirty, fleshy world of ours. It's crucial that that's true. So he wants to make that argument. On the other hand, there are many people of that day, and I think in today's society too, that say that true power, true leaders, don't get themselves killed. John is writing 70 to 100 years after Jesus was crucified, and there are many for whom his death by an empire in a public crucifixion shows that he had no power. So John is writing in a way to say, no, the flesh and the body that is part of the divine, and also to be crucified, does not mean that the powers and principalities win, that Jesus had no real power. He's threading that needle, and he's making the argument that Jesus is something else between those two. And he does so by telling the story of Jesus. The Greeks are curious, and we get that refrain that we see a lot in John, the invitation to come and see. And Jesus starts teaching. So what is he teaching? What is he really teaching? What is he really saying? Beyond all the metaphors and his talk of my father's stuff, when you really boil it down, he's talking to close friends and to some new faces, and he's saying, my death is coming. It'll be okay. God is glorified in it, because my death isn't the end for me and not for you. The powers of Jesus' day, and still here and now in our days, use death and the threat of death to flex the muscles of control. But Jesus shows that even death means little in the face of God. For the living God, for the risen Christ, for the Holy Spirit, death can bring about resurrection, and in fact, death is really all that can. Nothing in this world lasts forever. Life is short, and seasons change. We see signs of new life now as we walk and ride our bikes and drive our cars and ride the bus around town. We see these signs of new life. So does this mean that we just go through the motions and don't care? Does this mean that grief is just an annoying pest that needs to get over itself? Well, heavens no. Grief needs to be felt. It demands to be felt. We don't shut it out. In fact, we embrace it as part of what it means to be human. It's a vital part of the cycle in this world that God has created and ordered. A few months ago, I was listening to an interview with someone named Caitlin Curtis. She's an author, she's a poet, she's a storyteller, she's a speaker. She's an enrolled citizen of the Potawatomi Nation and writes on the intersections of spirituality and identity. If I remember correctly, she was born and raised in Oklahoma on a reservation, but was raised Southern Baptist, and for the longest time never really reckoned with her identity, with one side of her family being indigenous and what that means in her Christian life, and the other part of her being white and Baptist in Oklahoma, but yet still on a reservation. I was introduced to her through her book Native. And the interview I listened to was about her new book that's titled Living Resistance, an Indigenous Vision for Seeking Wholeness Every Day. And she started talking about cycles. And there was a brief moment where I thought, oh gosh, Patrick, don't tune out. It's going to get real trippy. Stay with it. She's on to something. And essentially what she said in the interview, and obviously she says it much more poetically and beautifully than I will right now, but she talked about seeing her own life and invited others to see their lives, not always as some linear timeline, from birth until whatever's going to come toward the end of your life, but through the patterns found in your life's cycles of death and resurrection. as you hit a crossroads in your life, think about those cycles that you've already gone through before. How has your life been ordered in these kinds of cycles, where things die and new things are brought to life? As I was reading one of the commentaries on this passage from Dr. Dong Hyung Jung, who's professor of New Testament at Garrett Evangelical Theological Seminary, he alluded to some of this idea of seeing resurrection and death, and resurrection and death in his commentary on this story in John's Gospel. He wrote how even in times of death and despair, we can still find a path to hope. Quote, "While believing that we will see the rays of divine light and the joys of the blessed reign in our lives, in all of these scary moments, we are invited once again to let go of all of ourselves so we can be buried and resurrected in Christ." So Jesus, in this moment, he's not just talking about his own death, but he's inviting us into that same cycle of death and resurrection, an invitation to affirm that death is not the end. Death and despair and destruction do not get the final say. Resurrection follows, and hope follows, and Easter always follows. And in the cycles of our lives, we have so many opportunities to garden some goodness, to get our hands dirty in that soily work of compassion and justice, holding one another as we travel through seasons of grief while keeping watch for signs of resurrection. That's not always easy. Friday morning, I got a text from a good friend in Northwest Ohio, the church where I first served out of seminary. She was actually the chair of the PNC that called me, and we became very close, still are close. Her name's Lynn. She texted me to hold someone in prayer named Katrina. When I got to Ohio in 2015, Katrina just started college. When she was 16, she had a heart transplant. So the college that she wanted to go to that was farther away, she had to stay a little closer to home. I got to know Katrina well. She was one of the first people that wasn't on the search committee I got to talk to. She helped me pick out a tie before my first sermon at that church, because the one I was staying at their home that night, and the one I came downstairs in apparently was too dad-ish. She was hilarious. Bright red hair, great sense of humor, very sassy, incredibly smart. She graduated from Bowling Green State University. She was a teacher. She loved teaching. She was actually part of the group I took to a college conference at Montreat, and got to introduce her to Montreat. Although when we were in the mountains, I told her, like, oh, I just love being at home in these mountains. And she said, oh, growing up in Northwest Ohio, I feel too closed in. I need those big, long fields where I can really see. Her mom, Becky, was also on the PNC that called me there. They became close to Becky and her husband, Joe. Becky's a nurse, and this past Friday morning, I guess Katrina was over there visiting her folks. She's now a seventh grade math teacher nearby. She had an episode, and her mom was doing CPR, and they were hoping they could get her airlifted to the Cleveland Clinic. But there's been tornadoes and storms going through that area, and when I reached out, I learned that Katrina had died before they were able to get her to Cleveland. She's 27. And I'm hoping to be at the funeral Friday morning up there, get back Friday night. So as I'm writing this sermon, as I'm thinking about this idea of death and resurrection and that grief, we can still find joy, I don't know if I'm able to make it on Friday, what joy I might see at the funeral of a 27-year-old. And what hope and joy her parents losing their only child and her friends and that college community and her seventh grade students, what joy and hope that they will see or feel. But somehow, I know in that community, in that way that they can embrace and love on each other, I trust and I believe that somehow, even when we can't see the full picture, resurrection can still be possible and still be right at our front door. that we have opportunities to really garden some goodness as we work in the dirt together. And trust that that little grain of wheat will, in fact, bring new life, even as we grieve its death. But until then, we try to garden up some goodness and love on one another. We keep watch when we don't feel it for signs of resurrection. And that's where we find ourselves in this Lenten season, to travel toward Good Friday and the pain of the cross, hoping that Easter Sunday will come, even when it feels a lot further away than we'd like to. In the name of the triune God of faith, hope, and love, amen. For our practice of silence today, I invite you to be comfortable in however you're sitting. If you want to get on the floor, if you want to stretch, if you want to just stay in your seat, whatever feels comfortable to you. Close your eyes or look outside the windows or look at the candles or look at the beautiful flowers that Jerry brought. Listen to the wisdom that we find in the silence and the work of the Holy Spirit as we practice this together. As we go to our offering, I'll pass the offering plates around and encourage you to hear the spirit in the singing of our Evergreen singers and with the beauty that they offer this morning. clap here. Yeah, go ahead. Holy God, for what we can offer with our voices and the gift of music, what we can offer with our resources, what we can offer with our whole selves, our imaginations and our hearts, we give you thanks and we pray that it goes to your dream of compassion and justice for this world. Amen. I invite you to rise in body or spirit as we sing our doxology together, the words printed in your bulletin. As you go out these doors, as you go into your week, know and trust that you go with the love of God that nothing in life nor death can separate you from. And know that even where there is death and there is despair, resurrection does come. Resurrection will come. So be on the lookout. And in the meantime, get your hands a little dirty and garden some goodness. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. Amen.